Okay, so funding. So in this topic, or in this main chapter, we were talking about the following issues. So first of all, markets. Actually, I would like to talk about interesting stuff because this can be completely boring, but because the Madura book talks about these issues for pages. Oh, I did not mention it here, but there is a really long chapter about all of these market-related issues. But since you learned international finance, some part of it can be completely boring, so that's why I will focus on the interesting parts. Then, long-term funding. So until this point, we were talking only about long-term funding during the valuation part. So from valuation point of view, this entire funding cost was only relevant because we have to determine the average cost of capital, so the VACC had to be determined, and also we have to determine that what is the expected rate of return from the equity, and also it was easier because average interest rate had to be calculated and to see its importance. So in this case, I would like to talk about the volatile nature of interest rates in different categories, credit ratings and risk-related issues. And this will be something like this, and also convertible bonds. It has to be analyzed because, and also share repurchase programs will be mentioned here because mostly they are completely neglected by the book on one hand, but on the other hand, we have to talk about this because they are really significant from financial point of view and what is happening actually on the market and done by the companies. And also because due to COVID, these share repurchase programs became blamed so much because companies are lack of excess liquidity to deal with some slowdowns or lockdowns due to the plague. And then this is one of my favorite parts, financial lease. Will be summarized how can we, what is the concept in the IFRS. I even checked or double-checked it with the ladies at the accounting department. And also, how can we use them? And obviously, how can we price leasing contracts in, which is not so often available in many cases, that how leasing companies are defining the rates or lease fees, but we have some data about that, and here we can see that why these default rates were significant for us at the beginning, because they will be used by the leasing company to define the lease fee at the end of the day. So that's why bankruptcy is important from corporate point of view. And also we will have an offer. So it was an example for full service lease. I was just writing emails for different leasing companies around Europe that I would like to have Siemens Vectron locomotive, and we get a nice answer. It's not official offer, but they were really nice, so the MRCA company provided us a nice package. Now it's a bit outdated, but still we can see that what is happening there. And then we will close everything down with short-term funding. Yeah, these are the topics that I would like to talk about, and then let's see the markets. So, international money market, it's a nice place, and I would like to show you a nice example of how can we get short-term funding nowadays. So I will stop the recording. So, actually, when we have to talk about now we don't need this. When we have to talk about this international money market, it's actually short-term funding. So maybe short-term funds are available for multinational companies when they have to take up some loans on short run, and obviously for banks, so they are open definitely for them, but for medium-sized and not even absolutely not for small companies, they're completely not available. And so that's my really tricky that how you can use it, because if you are looking on the data set, that's how this market structured, then actually we can see that, oh, if you need US dollar liquidity, then usually what provides us money is US money market funds. So this US money market funds, they are collecting funding from US, not just US citizens, but US companies, US banks, and so on. And then after that, they are investing it partially in short-term government bonds. Also, they can put it into bank deposits, domestically or abroad. And we can see that mostly this money lands in Japanese banks, or nowadays it's not that popular to use it in the European Union or in Eurozone, because we can see that German banks reduce their US dollar exposure in the past. Also, banks in Switzerland, they were also reducing it. And what is this? Netherlands was also halving it. So nowadays it's not that popular. Why? Because it was really hard to manage by central banks. So ECB is still providing loans in US dollars, so even in 2020, to banks in the Eurozone to stabilize US dollar funding conditions and swap markets eventually. So what we were able to see last week, that swap base swap rates have really high volatility sometimes. So that's why many banks were fed up with this situation and they started to reduce this kind of exposure. And also, this excellent paper describes that in many cases, these money market funds are not providing loans or funding for not US entities or non-US entities because of taxation issues. So if taxation changes in the background, and this has happened in the middle of the 2010s, then they can turn towards US dollar or US treasury securities and they are saying goodbye. So that's why I'm a bit suspicious that, okay, it's nice to mention here international money market, just it's not for international companies. But also, we can find actually US dollars not just coming from the United States. So it can come also from European banks, because this is the euro dollar. So since the 60s, many banks raised deposits, domestic deposits in US dollars, and that's why they have loans to domestic companies also in US dollars, because they accumulated US dollars somehow, because of economic relationships. So if you are paid in US dollar, then sooner or later it will be accumulated and absorbed by the banking system. But also, if you are looking on other data, so there is always this report about the international role of euro. It's published twice in a year, always, and it says that, okay, euro as an international reserve, a global foreign exchange market, international debt and loan markets. So let's see, then euro as an invoicing currency, it can be also nice, but let's see, this 2.3. So So debt securities, it means bonds. And we can see that actually euro is the second most popular currency to denominate debt. So we can see that they have 30 to 20% of the debt market. But and actually we can see that the decline, it did not start in 2008, so it was not due to an external shock, so it maybe it has some other interference. And also it's funny to see that it was constantly decreasing until quantitative easing was initiated by the ECB, and now it's stagnating around here. So maybe that was, so since the ECB is there as a market maker of last resort, now market participants have still the willingness to issue the same amount of bonds in euros. And in the field of issuance from year to year, so this is the outstanding, so the entire mass of debt securities, and this is the annual issuance. We can see that, yeah, euro is a bit popular and it's there, but actually US dollar is way more popular because it's available for you. But this is not the shorter market, so this is about the international bond market. Actually, this is really interesting because I remember when in 2007 many companies, even in Asia, reported that now they are changing their US dollar reserve to euro or other currency denomination. So mostly euro was preferred at that time in the news because US dollar started to depreciate earlier because the crisis hit them faster in autumn of 2007. But we can see that after that it became really popular as a denominator of debt. So it jumped back to 60%.
Maybe they gave sort of loans to those emerging countries or something,
right? But it's private. It's private. It's supposed to be private.
People like green better.
It is private, so yes. There was also, short-term debt. So we can see that, so when Madura was writing the book, the short-term funding was popular. So this is this light, teal color territory. But after that, we can see that no, short-term funding disappeared from the market, so it's not that popular, because if there is a liquidity shortage, then you can hit yourself hard, and they did it, so now it seems that it's not a great idea. So after that we can find here many different stuff, but mostly corporate bonds, what is significant. Okay, the lowest point was in 2011, so since then it recovered. It's also really interesting that the Eurozone was mentioned always as a market where banks are dominating and corporate bonds are not that significant, and since then we can see that now corporate bonds are, or became significant from corporate funding. Also, there is this investment grade and high yield. So high yield means that they are risky companies. So they have a low credit rating. That's why they are representing high yield. We can see that now they have also a fancy market share. So it's this orange is what we can find here. Covered bond, I will talk about it. We can see that it also has a nice market share. Asset-backed security, mortgage-backed security, right now they are irrelevant, but we know from international finance that nowadays, or since 2014, they are the European Central Bank focuses on them, so they are also stabilizing the markets through market maker of last resort function. And actually, this sovereign debt is this thing here, so it's not that significant. That's also which companies are using or issuing US dollar denominated. This is the euro and this is the US dollar denominated debt. So we can see here public administration, so public debt, also financial and other services. Obviously, bank sector will concentrate. So they are sitting on half of or more than half of this market. But also we can find it construction and manufacturing, also trade and transportation sector. So we can see here other sectors as well. Now, green bond, I don't want to talk about this topic. There are not so many literature on this field, so yep. And euro in international loan and deposit market. So when we would like to take up just a loan, then still we can see that US dollar is the most important and euro is far behind that. So all other currencies have more importance than euro with this 10 to 20% of share. Is there any other interesting information? We can compare, at least there is the amount of money lent out in euros, and in this case we can see the ratio between, so corporate bonds. Nowadays we can find here $3 billion in, this is in euros. It's nice to say that they are denominating euro debt in US dollars, but okay. Yeah, and after that we can see that 1/3 of this can be identified as lending in euros. So that's why I was mentioning that in the past lending was much more important to get euro liquidity than bond issuance. So we can see here that here in 2000 it was maybe 80 or 60 billion, and here we can see that it's 80. So lending is, it's also volatile. So we can say that it was dramatically changing in 2008. It was changing in 2011. So when the second wave of the crisis started.
Yes.
So the investment grade is when the you have at least maybe credit rating of B. So you are at least investment grade. So it's not a speculative category. So in the case of leveraged, there should be some definition case for us, but because leverage means that you are using equity and debt combined, so there should be another phrase for that. that should be high yield, so that would be much more informative to say that the high yield would be that it's not investment grade, it's junk bond, but I don't know why they are using this terminology. Yep. Invoicing currency, it doesn't matter. So so what the book says about international credit market is that they are focusing on medium-term funding. So usually the average maturity is 5 years. So if you need 5 years of funding, then companies are going to the international credit market, so they are going to a bank, but usually not going to a single bank, so usually they are using the syndicated loans, so that's why in the case study I was using syndicated loans, because in this case one bank will be responsible for the lending procedure, so they are negotiating with the company, and the other banks behind this syndication or syndicate, they will provide just the funding. Because it will be nicer for them, they can diversify the risk, partner risk. Because you know that even in Basel II regulations, banks were limited to taking risk against a sector or against a company, so there are partner limits or sector limits. Or even sometimes, if I remember well, on my studies from 2006, so there were even limits, not just sectors, but also maybe at risk rating or something like this. So risk was also limited by this. And if you are providing syndicated loan, then actually you have the chance to avoid to reach this partner limit or to reach the level of industrial or sectoral limits. Because so it's good for regulation point of view, or to fit the current regulation, and also it's a nice risk management tool as well. And of course, syndicated loans are actually more expensive than original or traditional loans because to combine the offerings of different banks, you need additional negotiations, so that's why they will ask for a nice service fee. So it's funny that on one hand it's really good for the banks to provide something like this, but if you are looking for the details of these contracts, then usually it's more expensive for the corporate side. Also, usually in this case they are providing floating interest loans. So you are using they are usually using LIBOR as the benchmark, and LIBOR plus some percent will be the interest rate at the end of the day. So the premium will represent all corporate specific risks, and that's why if you want to trade away this risk, you will use swap contracts, interest swap contracts. So in this case, what can happen that you are paying for using the syndicated loans, so some service fee have to be paid, then you will get the loan for 5 years with the floating interest, then if you want to hedge out the interest risk, then you will go for another maybe investment bank and you will ask for a swap agreement, then you will pay also for the swap component, and at the end of the day you will be really happy because you have the loan and you have also a swap contract where you have a fixed interest rate and some service fees to be paid. So it's a nice market to work around. And also there is the international bond market, then you are collecting long-term funding. And And actually, I don't know why, but for Eurozone there are not so. So the base data is this source, but for the US we have excellent data sets. So US Fred database and so actually they have a, so the Fred is a huge database actually, but they have subsections like for corporate bonds, and in this case they have also subsections for different credit ratings. So this is why I like them so much, because if you have to compare that, what is the difference between credit ratings? Because it's a, yes, we can say that it's a nice definition of AAA, but what is the added value here? What is the difference between AAA and BAA? Or the not so nice section of CCC? So actually we can see here that, okay, if you are rated as AAA, and obviously Stoppel should be used here because we need the benchmark for US 10 Epsilon. So what is the interest rate for the government or long-term yields? Okay, then max. What? Yeah, okay, I was hitting with something else. Yeah, so we can see that US dollar, so for the US government, you can, as the US government, you can have liquidity at 5% of interest or yield or long run. So let's see that, is it better or not? So the scale is between the 70s. So they can see that what is the premium here, that this is for the government and this is for AAA rated companies. So maybe you have to pay 2.5% of yield, or if you are checking the same thing in oh sorry, it's from 1800s. Okay, maybe we should just check the last 50 years. Yeah. Okay, so without gold standard and two world wars. So now if we want to compare the data, well actually it will be hard to find any differences. So in the terrible 82, when it was at the peak point, highest something, well, it was maybe 13 or something like this percent. We can see that it was also 15%. So they are really close to the benchmark. What is happening with the government bond? Also, if you are checking 2001, when all the corporate scandals of Enron and WorldCom happened. That's it, 7.2. At the same time, government bonds were also around, let's say it's less than 6 or around 6. So you don't have to pay so much premium compared to government bonds in the US. 2008, October, yes, there was this huge peak. So we can see that it jumped from 5.6% to 6.3. So that was all the financial crisis. So if you are in AAA, then it's a nice place. Okay, but at the same time, if we are collecting data, maybe instead of this, we are looking for a nicer one, which is available on a longer time period. But it's supposed to be available earlier. It's not. No problems. Actually, mostly completely enough for us. It's still. And I can't change that part. Mostly. Please. Alright, if that became longer. Okay, but at least we can see that what happened in 2008, that it was jumping from 6.4 to 9. So why a AAA category it had not so many impact? Now we can see that the premiums started to increase. So usually the added value of credit scoring or credit ratio is that under turbulent times it increases the difference. So maybe if market is operating normally, then the different credit ratings are moving closely to each other. So there are it doesn't matter, or there are not so many differences in funding, that if the company or the country is rated as AAA or BBB, whatever. But if there is a liquidity shortage, there is a market shock, market sentiment changes, something terrible happens, then all the low quality assets are started to be punished by the market because they became really, so they develop this risk awareness. So they don't want to take excessive risk. And we can see that all interest rates or yields will jump significantly. So if a company had to issue bonds here, they were able to collect lots of money. But if they had to issue or renew their debt here, then obviously they were able to collect lower amount of capital from the same issuance. But still, it's something. So if we are going ahead and we are looking for the terrible part, so the triple C, so if a company is really close to bankruptcy, so that's the junk bond territory, then we can see that it was jumping to 36%. Which is actually really simple to the Greek case. So if you are saying that, no, GRY. So we can see that the Greek debt was also at, I remember 30 something. According to this scale, it's lower than 30, but the scaling is highly logarithmic, so let's say 35. And they are also counted as bad debtors. So we can say that, if someone wants to issue bonds here, good luck, because you are not able to collect so much capital. As in ordinary periods, when these companies were able to raise money with 4.2% of yield. So what you can get at lower quality or risk credit rating is volatility in yields. So you can live happily for years, but just suddenly market hits. Actually, last week I had a PhD defense. I had a really good PhD student from the Hungarian National Bank. I learned a lot from him. And he was analyzing the same thing, but from a sovereign debt point of view. And he had similar conclusions, just he had more fancier figures than this, but the message was the same, that actually volatility will emerge in lower credit ratings. But the benefit compared to credit markets, that in this case you don't have to negotiate with banks. So if you are happy, then you can sell your bonds, maybe here. And if you are lucky, then it will maybe not expire here, but when you have to renew, it will be more expensive. So, yes, you have to pay for the issuance, you have to pay for the credit rating. Once a year, you have to provide some information or some reports you have to deal with. But otherwise, you don't have to have any kind of, for example, collaterals. So you don't have to say that, okay, I can't sell this building because it's the collateral behind my bank loan. What is happening here in the international credit market? In this case, in the bond market, then you can say that I issued your bond, then you can hope that I will pay the interest. And I'm able to renew it once it expires. Do you have a question?
Yes. You said one of
the
things
you said are more expensive than the model. Yes.
Yes,
why would the national companies look like one of the companies? So, actually, General Motors was many years counted in the junk bond sector. And it was so General Motors was growing big, or it was already big in the 90s. So they had branches everywhere around the globe. But they nearly went to default. So partially they had to be bailed out by the US government in 2008, because they started to use even the pension funds money to stabilize the cash flows of the company. So even multinational companies can reach this level, and for them it can be relevant to see. But it's happening in the junk bond territory with triple C or close to C valuation. So actually, that's the relevance of this topic, because we are talking many things. So for example, a Boeing is still in category A somewhere, maybe it's single A or double A. I don't know what is General Motors right now. Let's see. Wow, now it's a BAA. That's nice. Okay, they were able to reshape the company efficiently because it was terrible in the past. Yep, and then international stock markets. I think that I was talking about it a lot in the past, so when we were talking about valuation and international acquisitions and mergers, So in this case, this chance of stock in foreign market. So if you are going to the US stock market, obviously you want to tap the liquidity in the US stock markets. So you need funding from there because it will be more cheaper than, for example, if you want to go to list your company in the Hungarian stock exchange, you will be really happy about it. Just the amount of liquidity is lower, what you can collect. So maybe your shares volatility will be also a bit higher. It will be denominated in an emerging currency instead of US dollar. So it has many problems. But on the other hand, you will be the subject of US legislation. And there was a huge popularity of IPOs made in US markets during the 90s. It was fueled partially by privatizations during the entire 80s and 90s. It was also fueled by emerging stories over the world. It was fueled also by the IT sector, which was at that time, they were establishing the entire IT sector, so it was completely groundbreaking. But since then, this thing stopped. So if you are looking, there is a really good article published by the Amber Public Listing. Yeah. Oh my god. Yeah, so this is the right side. And we can see, yeah, the numbers are still in thousands. Just in the US, there was this peak point when we were listing enormous amount of companies on stock markets, and after that, it decreased a bit, but it's still 5,000. In the non-US listings, it was still increasing, but with not that high levels. And after that, welcome to the new website. I can see it. It's new. Just I don't like it. The previous was nicer. So I met this with one of these guys. Maybe him. For him. I think that it was him in a conference many years ago when they made this paper public. And actually they were not able to say that the reason of declining listing was that, for example, Sarbanes-Oxley Act was initiated. So since then, if you are falsifying your figures, financial data, then the management can sentence to prison for 20 years. I don't think that it can be an ugly motivation to clear the company reporting, say, because it's actually also the benefit of the investors and also for the company later on, because they are not going to default with the likelihood like before. But still, we can say that they checked this variable in the paper, so they were running different regressions, and maybe we have some figures here. Oh my god, this is only just no text, or maybe the figures are at the end. Yeah, figures are at the end. I don't like the structure of papers, but so they were checking that if the country is big, or if it's growing, or it's growing and it's big, or it's not in the US, that it can be significant or not. Also, self-dealing was analyzed. It had also significant impact. Also, they were focusing on startups. But we know that emergence of startups are also seasonal. So if there is a new sector in the economy, like it happened during the dot-com crisis, then many new companies will pop up and they will be popular. Also, we can see during the 2010s that there was a second bloom of startups. Nowadays, we can see in the space, outer space sector, that also many companies are jumping out from nothing. So they are collecting enormous amount of venture capital investments, and some of them will go down, obviously. But at the end of the day, so if you are checking the paper, they were able to have non-conclusive results. So they were not able to define that what defines actually the peak level of this appetite for public listing, and why this curve can go down. But if you are looking on this region, actually Polish stock market became really popular. So many, not just Polish companies, but many companies in the region are listing in Warsaw Stock Exchange because it's big. And if it's big, then so it's a self-reinforcing cycle. Because if the market is big enough, then there will be many investment funds which are looking for investment opportunities. So if you have a stock-oriented investment fund, then you need stocks. And obviously you will go there when where there are enough amount of companies to select or to look for. Because if you are going to the Hungarian stock market, sorry guys, but you will find maybe three companies which are liquid, or maybe four companies which are liquid. Okay, it's a 40 company market, but most of them are useless, or so again, sorry for them, but maybe we can say six companies which are reliable, and which is not a joke. So Richter Gedeon, so it's they are manufacturing medicines, or MOL, which has these refineries, and actually they are have all the production line from extracting crude oil to processing it, and deal with chemical, they have chemical plants, and they can make plastic, so they are real companies, or OTP. But in Warsaw Stock Exchange you can find many of them. And also, and it's a secondary thing, that if the market is deep enough and big enough, then there will be special sectoral indexes. And nowadays actually index making is also really popular. This is the case of the ESGD reporting related issues. So nowadays many analyst company or investment fund, they are not just focusing on one stock market, but they are saying that, for example, we would like to focus on for investments on environmentally and socially sustainable companies. And sometimes from financial point of view we can say that it's underdefined and so on, but if we have ESGD scorings, and that's why if you have ESGD scores, or sorry, not ESG, ratings, for example, what MSCI have, but we have also other data sources. So they are, it's like a credit rating. So companies are paying for this rating, and after that MSCI or other service data providers, so also Thomson Reuters and other companies are doing these ratings. And after that they will provide you a rating like A, B or C and so on. And also there are, as you can see here, investment funds or ETFs which are looking for such companies. And if you are able to generate an investor story for your company that, oh, I'm in category A, then you have a chance to be part of such a portfolio that so your shares will be purchased by an investment fund. And investment funds are always nice owners because they don't have strategic objectives, so they don't want to vote against the management in most of the cases on a shareholders meeting, and they don't want to have hostile takeovers, so they are nice people to live with, and they are usually not that active. So that's why this attractiveness can be a thing here. Actually, we have a paper right now where we are focusing on banking sector and how this ESG ratings can have an influence on bank stability. But we have some results, but let's wait for the reviews because I have more doubts. So international stock markets are nice, but let's see one more nicer. Is the territory of venture capital funds. Because venture capital funding, so first of all, it's not just about startups. So in many cases, when we are talking about startups, that all companies where the growth potential is high. After that, we can see that it was fast growing or not, because we know that 9 of 10 startup companies are going to default several years later when they're realizing that they are not able to grow, or maybe they were able to grow, just they were not able to generate incomes or revenues. Actually, my favorite series is Silicon Valley. I can recommend you that because they are going through the 101 handbook of venture capital funding and startups. But actually, venture capital investments are mostly directed to old companies or old enough companies which has already a market share. So what venture capital funds are doing, it has a high added value because they are looking on companies and usually they have an expertise for one sector only. And they are saying that, okay, which part of the company can be valuable, which can provide us growth in the near future. So usually they have a field of view like for 5 years. So they are long-term investment, but not that long-term investment that they can sit on the company for until infinity. So within 5 years, they want to have their exit. It can be an IPO, it can be selling the company to another company, or it can be liquidation, which is not that happy thing. But until these 5 years, they are trying to position the company, or in many cases to reposition the company. So they are saying that, okay, this company divisions, these assets, these product lines are valuable, so we will keep them, the rest will be sold. Maybe we were outsourcing them, maybe we are using some more the services of some external service providers, so we will purchase them from the market instead of making it at home. Or in other cases, they can say that, let's make it at home. So, for example, when we are analyzing the case of Tesla right now, when they announced the battery day several weeks ago, when Musk was telling it to the press and the investors who were there in their cars, that they would like to focus also on the battery production, but inside the company. So not just outsourcing it as it was before to deal with LG Chemical and with Panasonic and other companies, but it was not just focusing on insourcing this production, but it was also to changing the technology. So they were talking about some processing plant which can recycle water, which can use table salt to extract lithium from soil. So it was some sort of technology which can make battery manufacturing cheaper, and also batteries can be bigger because they are somehow they can manage the heat processing of the battery. You know that if you are charging something up, it can generate heat, and it can be really warm in the case of a car-sized battery. Obviously, it stands from segments. So in this case, it can generate a story. When you can maybe grow your revenues. Obviously, what happened in Tesla case, it was market participants were not that happy because it generated additional investment requirements for the future, near future at least, because they have to open new factories, which means that additional investments are needed. So the perceived increase in generated cash flow can be moved to far away again. So let's go back to venture capital fund. So venture capital fund try to do the same thing. So they are, in many cases, they are purchasing companies which are really close to default, or maybe they are prospering, just not prospering enough, and they are recalibrating them. So usually they are delegating managers into the management, so they have some headhunting job. Also, they can negotiate bank loans to the company, so usually they have excellent banking relationships. What is also interesting that they are concentrated spatially. So usually what was in the literature that if we have a company in Silicon Valley, then usually they are only working with companies in the 100 kilometer radius. So where you can go within an hour and to deal with your business, and then you can go back. So in the movie, in the Facebook movie, I don't know what was the name of this. So one which was about the Facebook, and they were moving the company from New York, or I don't know what, so from the eastern coast of the US to the Silicon Valley, because that is where the venture capital funds are living. So in this movie, at least, they were showing us that the motivation that you want to be close. So it's a regional thing that you can have venture capital funds. Actually, nowadays, or in the last several years, I'm also doing some research on the field of aerospace sector, motivated by SpaceX and all the companies around this launching business and satellite business. And that was also a huge boom of small rocket companies. So, and usually there are nice, colorful prospects. That's, for example, that was the vector R. So usually you have some kind of picture like this, that okay, in the future they will have a rocket called Vector. So that was the company's name, of Vector Aerospace. And they were saying that okay, we are focusing on one segment of the market, so it will be CubeSat, because there are still huge satellites on the market, but the majority of the market is like this, not fridge size, but microwave oven sized CubeSats, which became nowadays way more popular. So usually the weight of one satellite is somewhere between 100 kilograms and 3 tons. So, but usually they are small. And that's why many companies were funded. So Vector was collecting less than $100 million, Then they went to default maybe 2 years ago. Let's check it, but I remember I was even listening to an interview. Yeah, sorry, last year they went to default. And before launching anything, so they went down before of that. Also, there is another company, Orbex Space. Let's use their corporate website. So it's located in England. Their launching facilities being built in Scotland, but also the technology is Ukrainian, so they are combining many things. Also, there is PRD Space. It's a Spanish company. Yeah, as we can see it here. It's nice, but I don't know why it's not speaking English, but okay. And also there is Firefly Alpha. Okay, because they are this one is exploded. I know that there are two companies. One is Firefly, the other is Alpha. Just I don't know why. You can see it here combined. So this company was looking for some money from the US defense budget. Right now they are making, maybe they are at their third nice explosion. So they were not able to launch anything at all. So now we can see that, okay, there is a blooming market. Everybody would like to build a rocket. Why? Because there is SpaceX. But actually, in the case of SpaceX, it's really tricky because there is no venture capital in the background. So when we are going to pricing, they are now really happy because they were able to launch 95 of their rockets, which they did it since 2010. So it's really fast speed of launching. But mostly what happened in the case of SpaceX that they did not have to collect funds from venture capital funds. They were able to collect funds from NASA. So that was seeding capital. And in the case of seeding capital, it's really comfortable because you can, so NASA said that, okay, here is such amount of money. So they were paying $400 million. It's ridiculously small amount of money compared to the SLS program that they spent $16 billion to nothing yet to be launched. So they were putting the money on the market, and SpaceX had one job: to develop a rocket and to develop a capsule which is not exploding, and it can deliver stuff to the International Space Station and bring it back, hopefully. They were developing it, and actually it provided orders and market for the company during the last decade. So that was a huge business success story, because this was the only and single company which was able to not to go default, not have to be bailed out by another company in this sector, and actually they were able to cut down the costs because of the reusable first stage, which was reused many times nowadays, so it's 41. So they were able to say that, okay, the first stage, this is the most expensive stuff or part of the rocket, it can be reduced. So you have to put kerosene and liquid oxygen inside of it, and then you can refly within the months without spending additional money on them. So that's why they were able to cut expenditures by 3 in this segment. So in this case, venture capital is a bit different because NASA never became the owner of SpaceX. They are just providing them a market and a safe market. And besides that, they can offer their services to other participants. So since then, actually SpaceX was eating up the private launching markets inside the US and outside the US as well. So nowadays, this Boeing, Lockheed Martin, United Launch Alliance is focusing absolutely only on defense contracts coming from Pentagon, or the European Ariane platform is mainly focusing on government or research related satellites, because the rest of the market is moving. Also, Russia was losing market, commercial market, because also it was eaten up by SpaceX. And since then, we can see that, okay, venture capital is annually $200 million is invested, or it was last year, it was invested to the US space sector only in the firm or form of venture capital investment. Just, I'm not sure about the degree of freedom. Because at the same time, this cake is not growing. So I can't say that suddenly an enormous amount of satellites emerged on the market, because now launching fees were cheaper. It was expected, maybe 3 years ago, that now it will be a thing. Just here we can say that it's a growing market. So right now we are cutting the cake to different pieces, and it can create some sort of consolidation on this market as well. So this is what I would like to stop here today, and next week we will continue with long-term funding specific issues.